Hey guys, this is my 2012 KTM 350 EXCF. It's already winter out there, and I thought I'm gonna start some maintenance work on it. I have this bike since, I don't know, I think about 5 months ago. We're in January now, and I bought it, I think, around September maybe. The bike was imported from Italy. It was in very 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 good shape. I had a lot of fun with it. I'm just a beginner, so I started riding dirt bikes at the end of the last summer. I think I did already about 50 hours on it. I didn't intend to do any kind of video or tutorial about it, but now that things got interesting, and I've searched online for a lot of instructions of how to do this job, and I didn't find very very well documented ones. Please know that I'm not a mechanic and I'm not an electronist. I actually work in IT, so my experience is quite limited. I do this just as a hobby. If you have anything to mention, just or you see me doing something wrong, just leave a comment down there. I didn't do anything to it since I have it. Just change the oil and filters quite often, and that was it. The bike was in a very good condition, as I said, and it ran just fine. I have only one small issue with it, and it's been like that since I bought it. The problem is that it starts quite hard. I looked online for all sorts of solutions for this issue, found a lot of people complaining about these models having starting issues. Some of them resolved it, some of them went to the dealer. The dealer said that it's okay for a bike like that to start this way. I'm not buying it, to be honest, because I purchased a fuel injected bike just for this reason, so I don't have starting issues. There can be a lot of reasons for the starting issues, like valves that are not adjusted, like TPS sensor not properly adjusted, battery drain, all sorts of issues. What I did so far was just installing a fan. So I bought a kit and installed it. It looks like this. It works fine. It starts up when it's needed. It's not always on. It has a temperature sensor there and it works just fine. So I'm gonna start diagnosing all these issues. All these components, just to make sure they are not the cause of the bad start issues that I'm running. It's starting rough, even if it's warm, even if it's hot outside, even if it's cold, or even if the bike is hot sometimes, I get a rough start during riding it. Okay. So as I said, this bike was imported from Italy. It had about 200 hours on the display there. But the problem is that when I bought it, the sensor that's on this front wheel didn't work, so it didn't record the hours. I don't have any kind of service history on this bike, so I don't know what has been done and when. I know that around 200 hours for this model you should or might need to change the piston. I'm not there yet. I want to speak about the hour meter that didn't work. So how that works is that on the front wheel, somewhere here on the disc brake, we have a magnet, as you can see it right here, and there's a sensor that reads it. Some of the persons, I think, just remove the cable, so it doesn't record the hours. I don't know why. Maybe they can sell it better, showing low hours, or I don't know. I had a different problem with this one. Actually, the cable that was going to the sensor was broken here by a branch. I fixed it, and now it records the hours, and it shows me also the speed. But yeah, that's it. What if you don't get the speed and the hours recorded on the display, the first thing to check is to see if you still have the magnet here, and check then the cable from the sensor to the display, and check that it's fine. Okay. I would also like to set the idle RPM. This one doesn't have a Tahoe, and I don't have a tachometer. I'm gonna think about how to measure them, but until we get there, I'm actually starting with the valve adjustment, because it's time for a valve adjustment, and the most important thing you need when you do this kind of job is to have to invest like $10-$15 on the best service manual for exact model of the bike, because everything here is aluminium, and you need the torque wrenches to torque the screws properly, otherwise you're gonna damage the engine. Sorry. So the first thing when you start doing the valves, I'm gonna do them by myself, it's not a difficult job, is actually to clean the bike properly, not as I did it, because I failed to clean it here. So I just ran at the end of the autumn, I just washed it and stored the bike in the garage. But now if I remove the tank that's over there, I removed it, and you can see all this dirt can drop down into the engine. So you, before taking the cover of the engine off, you need to make sure you clean very good this area. I use a piece of cloth here and I packed it so I don't get anything back there. I removed it just for the purpose of this video. So I started recording this a bit late because I didn't intend to do it at first, to record it, but then I thought that maybe some people will just find this information useful. So the first thing, you need to clean the bike. Then you need to remove the water from the engine, the coolant actually. I removed it because I wanted to remove also this right radiator from here, because it makes the job a lot easier. So anyway, the coolant was supposed to be changed also. To remove the coolant, just remove this screw here at the bottom of the water pump, the lowest one, and open the radiator cap, and all the coolant should flow out of the engine. Now the engine is with no coolant inside. I've already removed everything, but just put them back temporarily so you can see the steps I took, because as I said, I wasn't intended to film it. So I'm gonna show you the next step that you need to follow. The next step is to have the engine at the top dead center. Because this is the requirement for the valve measurements. To get the engine at top dead center, if you remove the engine cover, you're gonna see here. Let me grab a light. Maybe you're gonna see better. One second. So you can see here, there's marks here above the cams. So these are the cam lobes, and you have two cams. One is the intake cam, this one, that's coming from the throttle valve, and this is the exhaust cam that's on the exhaust side. And above each cam, you can see there are dots that need to align with that plate. This one is a bit difficult to see here, but there's a dot there and a dot after the lobe. So you need to put the bike in a higher gear while on the stand and just rotate the wheel until you get those aligned as described in the manual. Once they are aligned, you can actually lock the engine at top dead center. And that's very easy. You have a screw here. You remove this screw. It's here on the rear brake side, on the right side of the bike. You remove this screw, and this screw has a... I'm not sure how it's called in English. Let me search for it. Has a groove. I think it's called groove. It's a copper groove like this. See? You remove the screw, remove the groove, and screw it back. When you screw it, you should look inside, because you need to make sure the engine is at perfect top dead center, so you don't push the assembly with the screw. So when you look with the light in that hole of the screw, you're gonna see that it will align another hole there, and you make sure that's aligned. Then you screw this back without the groove. And very important, when you finish and attempt to start the bike, don't forget to remove the screw and place back the groove to unlock it. So that's very, very important. Okay, sorry. I don't have any video equipment, I just have my GoPro, so I actually place my helmet and the GoPro on the helmet so I can properly film this. Okay, so once you have the engine at top dead center, we will need to remove this part here. So the cams, this part that holds the cams in place, and the cam chain tensioner that it's here. Before removing the cam chain and the part here that holds the cams, I marked, if you can see here, I made a few markings on the chain and on the sprocket to be able to install it properly and easily back. Once you have removed that, once you have actually marked what you need, we're gonna remove this one. There's the plug there. We'll put this aside. Somewhere I'm gonna put it here. You can see the screws, I already removed them, and I'm gonna place them in order there. That has been removed. Then we can remove the cam chain tensioner. It has here, actually, it's a bit removed now because I already did it, so you have to unscrew this one, the small one here, with an, I think it's an Allen key, a 5mm Allen key, and once that's removed with a 24mm wrench, you can remove this one. So while we take it out, you're gonna see here the tensioner. that has an O-ring. It won't look like that because when it comes out, sorry, it's gonna be extended like this. When you put this back, I think it would be wise to remove to replace also this this O-ring here, and I think there's another O-ring here on this one. I don't know if you can see it inside here, see? So that one should be replaced also. When you install this back, this will need to be actually pressed until somewhere around this line. If you overpress it, it will extend again. So I've seen a lot of videos with different ways that people do this. Some of them are just placing some are placing it like that, and are placing for example a groove. This is probably too thick here, and are pressing this until the right moment, until it sticks here only a bit out. Others I've seen, they are placing this in a vise like that, and are using the vise to lock it in place. You need to make sure you won't go further than this. See what happens now if I go further? It will actually extend back to the original size. I'm not gonna put this one back. I've already purchased a new one. I wanna change it. I'm not sure how was the condition of this one. So this will not be installed back. Okay, once that is removed, you can remove the screws. There are 8 screws holding this in place. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. The manual states that when you install this back, you need to torque this from inside out in crisscross pattern. So do this. I did it the same when I removed it. So this should now come out like that. Okay, I'm gonna place it here. And now you should be able to remove the cams. They have wheel bearings here. Because we removed the tensioner, the chain is quite loose now. I already have my markings done, so I can remove this cam here. Okay. And I'm gonna place it here. I didn't show you actually how to measure. Sorry, I'm gonna put it back for a minute. Of course, before doing this, you should measure the valve clearance. So while the engine is at top dead center, and you don't remove the cam chain tensioner, you don't remove this thing that is holding the cams, you're gonna use some filler gauges. Let me see where mine. Mine are here. They look like this. I prefer to have them removed because they are all kept on a screw, and it looks like that. I prefer to have them removed. The manual states that let's see. What the manual says. Anyways, the manual says that the intake ones should be between 0.10 and 0.15 millimeters, and the exhaust sides should be between 0.13 to 0.18 millimeters. So you take the filler blade like a 0.10. So the problem is that the valve clearance will get smaller and smaller in time, because obviously the valves will go bad and bad and bad, and they will just come up and up and up. So that clearance will be smaller in time. You don't usually have loosened valves, you have in time two tightened valves. So you take the gauge, you need to have small hands, and try with the gauge here. So you're gonna be actually using this one between the lobe, between this lobe and this, I'm not sure how it's called, I think it's a rocker arm, something like that. So this, we're on the exhaust side, we should have here a blade that's between 0.13 to 0.18 millimeters. If you can't get here a blade of 0.13, it means that it's too tight. So I've actually already measured this, and it looked like that. Okay. Let me put back the blade. I don't want to lose it. Well, it's difficult to do this with a helmet on. Okay, so what I measured here, there's a lot of numbers. I'm having the engine like that. It's the intake here. This is the intake, and this is the exhaust cam. So I measured here 0.09 in my measurements for the intake valves, which were tightened, because I need at least 0.10. And on the exhaust side, I had a 0.13, that's just at the limit here on this one. And on this one, I had a 0.11, which is too tight also, because I need at least 0.13. Now, let me go back and remove also this cam. I've seen people that use a piece of wire just to get this chained like here, because if I'm gonna remove this one here, the chain might go down into the engine. So I'm gonna use actually a wrench here, and we'll hold the chain like that, so it doesn't drop into the engine. Some people I see with a piece of wire just hang it here. Okay, I'm gonna put this here also. So this is the exhaust, and this is the intake cam. You can also see on the exhaust cam, it has this lever that's decompressing one of the valves to be able to kickstart it easily. So now with those removed, we can see here these rockers that actually press on the valves itself. So you have the valve here. It has a tensioner and a retainer, and here there's a thing called a shim. We can remove that using a magnetic tool. Here it is. Sorry, a bit messy here. So if I get the magnetic tool here, I can just remove the shim. So I'm gonna take this shim, and you're gonna need the tool to measure it. I'm using quite of a cheap tool, but apparently it doesn't work really bad. So this one, I'm setting it to zero, and I'm gonna measure the shim. It's 214. It should be 212, I think. Some of them are marked here to 12. The original ones weren't marked, we're almost there, so I told you it's not a very precise tool. So you measure this, you write them down, and then you can calculate what size you need. So usually you need a smaller size than the ones installed, because I told you that the valve clearance is actually getting lower and lower. I'm gonna install that back because this is the good one. This is the new one. I'm gonna lubricate them a bit. Okay, so after I measured all of them, this one was, so this is like this. This one was 215, 213, 217, 215. And I know that I had these gaps here, which were wrong. And I calculated the values that I need. I calculated I need 210 here, 211 here, 207 here, 212 here. There's an online calculator page that you can use where you enter the measured values and it tells you exactly what do you need. I didn't find at the local shop these values. I could find 212, for example. So I bought 3 212 and 1 208 for this one. So I think it should be good now. And that's it for the measurements. Now I'm gonna install this everything back here. I have already installed the new shims in there. I'm not gonna film the way I installed them back, because I don't think it's gonna be anything interesting there. I'm gonna use some engine oil. I'm using the Motul, this one. I'm using the 10W60 on this engine. So I'm gonna use some engine oil to lubricate these parts where the cams will sit. I'm gonna carefully place them back and use the markings on the chain. And after that, I'm gonna install the new chain tensioner. I already have the O-ring, the big one and the small one, as I showed you. And I'm gonna install it back. When you put that back together, I'm gonna use the manual, the torque that the manual states. Let's see if I have it here. So it says here to mount the screws and tighten them from outside to the inside at 14 Newton meters. It's important to lubricate the screws with some engine oil. So I'm gonna lubricate also this part here and also the screws. And then I'm gonna tighten them from outside in using the torque that is specified. Then it says that you need to install the cam chain tensioner. Lock timing. And it says that it needs to be tightened with 25 Newton meters. That would be a difficult one because it's quite difficult to have the wrench here. I'm gonna see how I'm gonna do that. And then to release it, because you saw that when it's new it's like this, then to release it we need to press that thing there and that will release the spring. So this is a hydraulic one. I think it has the spring, and then it uses oil pressure to tighten the chain. We're gonna press that one. It says here that you need a special tool. I don't have the special tool, but I'm gonna try something. We're gonna figure out something to release that. So once that will be released, the chain will be fixed again. Okay, so we are back. I've installed everything back. I didn't crank the engine because the chain tensioner that I installed is new and it's not full with oil. It doesn't have a proper tension on the chain, and I wouldn't want to rotate the engine just yet. But I'm gonna take another measurement of the valve tension. So I'm gonna take my filler blades. Let me get a piece of a clean cloth. Okay. Let me get only the ones. So there are two types of filler gauges. Ones are like this. I found this useful on a Yamaha, because the space is quite tight, and so you need this type of gauges. But I found it easier to work with the bigger ones here on the KTM. Let me just get from here the ones that I need. So I'm gonna take this one, 0.10. 09, 06, 08, this I don't need. Okay, I have a very bad 05, I have the 07, and that's it. 0.10, 0.12, 13, 98 also. Point 15. I'm gonna use the 15 also. Let's see what depths I have here. Point 60. Point 05. No. Point 10. Already. Point 20. Let's get 20 also. Okay. Okay. Let's use what we have and see what we get. So we said that the intake should be between 0.10 and 0.15. So first of all, I'm gonna use the 0.10 and check the first valve here. And I should have this one. Remember that this one didn't fit in the past. So this one fits now here. I have a bit of a drag. So that's not bad. And I'm gonna try the 15. Let's see if I can use this one. So 0.10 works, that's good. This shouldn't work. Okay, so this doesn't fit. So we're cool on this one. I know that it's between 0.10 and 0.15. For the exhaust, we should have the 0.15 going in fine. Okay, so we have 0.15 just at the limit. There, it's barely going in. No, actually, let me try it from this side. I should do it. Okay, so 0.15. Sorry, it's not that way. You remember that the rockers are staying like that, so we need to check between the rocker and the lobe. So we need to come with all of them from this direction. So 0.15 works. It looks like a 0.15 now. I hope the 0.20 will not go there. Okay, so 0.20 doesn't work. Let's try a combination of point, the maximum should be 0.18. I'm gonna use the 10 and the 0.8 together. Let's see like that. Okay, so they don't work. Let's try 0.17. I'm gonna use the 10 and 0.7. Okay, 17 doesn't work either. 16, do we have a 0.6? 0.6. Okay, so 16 works. So we have 0.16 on the exhaust. We are in the middle, so we are cool with it. I'm gonna go to the other side. Let's see. This side now. I'm gonna go to the exhaust. This one doesn't work. So let's try a 0.15. Do we have a 15? We have a 15. Doesn't work either. Now I'm getting a bit anxious. 0.15. Let's try 14. I hope it doesn't get lower than 13. Otherwise I'm screwed. 14 is the limit. So I have 0.14 here. Probably 13 will fit fine. I cannot measure 13. Can I? I can use the 0.7 and a 0.6. That's 13. Let's see this way. Yes, so I have 13. I'm at the limit on this exhaust. One. That's too bad, I didn't find. So see, 13 is working fine. We have 7 and 6. Hope my math is correct. And on the intake, again, I couldn't fit in the past the 0.10. Let's try with this one. Such a tight space here. Okay, so I have a 0.10 here. I'm right on the limit again. I don't like this. Because soon I'm gonna need to redo this. So 0.10 is quite there. And the 0.10 is the lowest limit for the intake. As you see, 0.10. Okay, so we're at the limit with this one though. It's definitely better. It was less than 0.9 last time I tried. Well, that's bad. I was hoping that let's see the 0.9. Where it can go in three. Yeah, so the 0.9 is extremely loose. 0.10 again. Yeah, 0.10 fits. Okay, so we're on the limit with this one. So this left side, both intake and exhaust, are at the limit. We should have taken a lower pill. But this was all I could find, so unfortunately we're gonna have to live with that. Probably next winter I'm gonna do them again. But this is it. I hope I'm gonna be able to fix the starting issues. Maybe the valves were a problem. But we never know. So now I'm gonna put everything back together. I'm not gonna film it, putting it back together. And I hope that we're gonna start it. I'm gonna film it on the first crank. It will be extremely interesting because we expect a very, very big rattle from the cam chain until the pressure builds up in the tensioner and will press the chain. So I'm a bit nervous about that. But yeah, that's it for now. I'm gonna do that and see what's going on. I was looking at the water pump because I noticed there's a small leak here, so I might open also the water pump and maybe apply some Permatex there, some gasket sealant. Maybe it will do some good things with it. Okay, we'll see you back when I'm gonna crank it and see how it works. If it starts fine, I'm not gonna bother further with investigating why it's not starting properly, because obviously it was the valves. Otherwise, we're gonna continue to the TPS and maybe I'm gonna find a way to measure the rotations per minute, so to set the idle as the manual requests it, because between 1950 and 2050 rotations per minute, revolutions per minute. And I have an idea for that. I have an oscilloscope, so I could use that one. I could get a signal from the coil, and I assume the coil is excited by the ECU for every detonation. So I could measure the frequency that it's being sent to the coil. We know the engine is measuring in rotations, revolutions per minute. We also know that for a four-stroke engine, we have an ignition event every two revolutions. That's where the difference between the four-stroke and the two-stroke. The two-stroke, you have more power because you have an ignition event every revolution. For the four-strokes, basically, the piston moves up and down twice for every event, ignition event. So we can measure the, we can take the oscilloscope and get the frequency that gets to the coil, and then we can multiply it by two and then convert it, because the frequency is measured in hertz, and that's oscillations per second. So we will be able to convert that to rotations per minute, revolutions per minute. It's just math. Okay, I would have liked to adjust the TPS also, but I don't want to mess with it a lot, because obviously this bike has been desmoked, or I'm not sure how it says, and I'm definitely sure it doesn't have the original map on it. I have a map selector there. I think it already runs richer than it's supposed to run. I'm not sure exactly how these are tuned, but I assume it's an alpha N tuning method where everything is calculated based on the TPS. That's a weird tuning solution. It's usually used only on race cars, and yeah, we'll see about that. I don't want to mess with it yet. I'm not sure what the values are now, but we can measure it. There are tools for that. You can buy from tpstool.com a tool that can help you measure the throttle position sensor value. Basically, you're measuring the voltage dropout on that sensor. So it's like a potentiometer that you have on an amplifier or something. So the resistance modifies as you actuate the throttle. It moves with the throttle. So basically, DCU reads the voltage drop on that that resistance. I don't have the tool for it, but I have multimeter, so we can use a multimeter to read that option, to read that value also. I know in the manual list it's that the original value for that should be 0.601. And there's a lot of topics on different forums about how people modify that value. Basically, if you increase the value, it will reach in the engine, and if you lower the value of the TPS, it will be less rich, and you're gonna have a poor mixture. Okay, we're gonna see further. I'm gonna install everything back. I think I'm gonna handle the water pump too, and I'm gonna apply the sealant, and I'm gonna get back to you when I'm gonna first start it, and we can also hear together the dead rattle, because it will definitely rattle. Okay, so it's time to try to power on the bike. Took it outside, closed everything. I hope I connected all the wires. So I'm gonna pull the choke. Okay. The choke and prime it once. Now let's see. Better than it was. Started quite fast. Okay, so now the engine is warm, still having starting issues. Try it again. I hear a ticking noise here in the front. Seems like it's going away.
See? I think.
Now if I wait 30 seconds, it will start. Here. Not sure. The exhaust leaking? I don't know. So that is it for today. I did the valve job. It seems alright. It started better when cold with a choke out, and then you saw that when it was warm, if I turn it off and try to start it immediately, it doesn't want to start very fast. If I wait for 20 seconds, 30 seconds, it just starts with no issues. So that is quite of a weird thing. Also, I can hear a ticking sound somewhere here in the front of the engine. I'm not sure exactly what it is. It's not now. It was always like that. Since I have it, so that is quite weird. I don't see any leaks. I'm gonna check it again tomorrow. There's no water leaks, coolant leaks, there's no oil leaks around the cover, so that's good. This is not installed. I just put a gas tank to be able to start it. I'm gonna remove the tank and continue my investigation with the starting. I want to check the TPS, but I think I'm gonna do a different video. So I think that's it. Leave a comment, like and subscribe if you like it, if you find it useful. If you saw me doing some mistakes, just tell me about it, and that's it. Thank you very much.